Welcome back everyone. Today I got my hands on a mini PC from Beelink. This model is called the Beelink Mini S12 Pro and it runs on an Intel Alder Lake 12th generation N100 CPU running on 16 gigs of DDR4 RAM and 512 gigs of internal storage. In this video, we take a look at what it can do on these specs, its expandable storage features, its gaming performance, and I'll run some benchmarks to see where it ranks on my chart. So if you are into mini PCs, alternative operating systems, and retro gaming, stick around, my full review is up next. Welcome back after that quick unboxing. And this package contains the Mini S12 Pro model itself. You get one HDMI cable, a second shorter HDMI cable for mounting behind monitors, a 12 volts 3 amps DC power supply, a bracket and screws for mounting to the back of your monitor, and a user manual. Its design consists of a plastic shell with the Beelink logo at the top. For I/O, it consists of dual HDMI 2.0 ports, 1 Gigabit LAN port, 2 of 4 USB 3.0 ports, its DC power socket, its exhaust vent, and a Kensington lock to its rear. To both sides has intake vents. To the front has a second pair of USB 3.0 ports, a headphone jack, a clear CMOS button, and an LED power button. And to its base has 4 anti-skid rubber feet, a pair of screw holes for mounting to the included bracket, and 4 screws with a rubber handle to remove the bottom panel to gain access to its internal components and its SATA expandable storage compartment. For internal components, it comes with a 512GB NVMe 2280 M.2 SSD, a single 16GB 3200 SODIMM DDR4 RAM module, and it has a SATA expandable storage compartment. So this is how it looks on a desktop, and here is how it fits seamlessly behind your monitor. So once you complete the Windows first startup wizard, you will have a fully registered version of Windows 11 desktop. It shows here in the basic system information that the CPU is an Intel N100 processor, and what was shocking is that it has a base clock speed of 800 MHz. This is the lowest I've seen a base clock speed, and immediately I anticipated that this was going to be a very slow, lazy mini PC. However, it's quite the opposite. This is the first time I've seen a mini PC boost clock speed function so efficiently. Its 4 cores when idle drops to as low as 500 MHz, and in a split second with a simple shift of the mouse, it cranks up to 2.9 GHz, and under intensive activities, it peaks at 3.3 GHz. It comes with 16GB of DDR4 RAM and it's a 64-bit operating system. Under product key and activation shows that its Windows key is activated. For some more details, Ada 64 shows its CPU is a quad-core Intel Alder Lake N100 processor with 4 cores and 4 threads as shown here by CPU-Z, and it has a boost clock speed of 3.4 GHz. The RAM module shown on the inside is a crucial 16GB DDR4 3200 SDRAM module running up to 1600 MHz. The RAM slot itself can take two types of RAM, 3200 DDR4 up to 16GB and 4800 DDR5 up to 32GB single module. Its GPU is built into the CPU, so in fact, it's an APU, and that component is the Intel UHD graphics. It has a base GPU clock speed of 399 MHz and a boost clock speed of 750 MHz. Its memory size information is inaccessible as it's part of the APU, and these are its graphics features. So for gaming, you get Vulkan and OpenGL 4.6. The audio adapter on this SBC is the Realtek ALC897. For storage, it shows that the M.2 NVMe SSD is a 512GB generic model, and it also detects the 1TB Western Digital SSD I installed into the expandable storage compartment. Its wireless network adapter is the Intel Wi-Fi 6 AX101, and it also provides Bluetooth 5.2 connectivity. So now that we have seen its hardware, let's look at some of the things we can do with this mini PC. First, it has 4K 2160p resolution with HDR display with the ability to change its orientation from landscape to portrait mode, reverse portrait and reverse landscape. You get dual monitor extended display, and you can extend a third monitor or TV via its wireless display feature. For audio, when connected to 5.1 or 7.1 PC speakers or connected to an AV receiver, you can get 5.1, 7.1, Dolby Atmos for home theater, and DTS:X for home theater. Also, its audio adapter can output all surround sound audio formats. Here it produces Dolby Atmos.
The world's first object-based cinematic audio. With powerful moving audio that transcends.
Next, Dolby Digital Plus.
Whether the soundscape sets the mood of a scene. Or your vehicle on the side of the road. Whoa!
This is DTS HD Master Audio. From Dolby Vision videos, you get the Dolby Surround. It produces Dolby True HD.
Next, we have the center channel.
And DTS:X. When playing 4K video format, it needs no additional media players or decoders. However, unlike Android boxes, the HDR feature does not trigger automatically for video playback. You have to first turn on HDR in the display settings and then proceed to play videos. I found that the movie and TV media player plays better than the default media player. It plays HDR 10, HDR 10 Plus, AV1, Dolby Vision, and HLG videos. However, Dolby Vision videos don't trigger the Dolby Vision feature if you are connected to a Dolby Vision TV. Also, HLG videos seem to have a latency issue where the audio is not in sync with the video. This is a simple HDR10 video. Here's an AV1 video. This is a Dolby Vision HLG video. Here's another Dolby Vision, and this one has Dolby Atmos. This is HDR 10 Plus. And this is the HLG video that has the latency issue. So video editing is not the best. Here I've loaded a 4K video clip into the timeline of Camtasia, and the project size is set to 1080p. As you can see, playing and editing the timeline is not very smooth, so it's recommended to use only 1080p video clips and keep the length of the video below 10 minutes and you'll be fine. Anything above that could result in freezing and long delays. Let's take a look at some benchmarks and where it ranks on my chart. First, its RAM transfer speed and its M.2 NVMe SSD read and write speeds. It has a RAM transfer speed of 6,187 megabytes per second. Its M.2 SSD has a read speed of 413 megabytes per second and a write speed of 807 megabytes per second. In testing its network speeds, its Wi-Fi 6 dual-band Wi-Fi adapter reached the maximum speed of my network of 154 megabits per second on its 5 GHz band. Its 2.4 GHz band averaged around 77 megabits per second. Its Gigabit LAN port also achieved the maximum speed of my network. In directly benchmarking its N100 CPU, the Geekbench 5 CPU benchmark recorded a score of 1,000 single core and 2,721 multicore. In benchmarking its GPU, the 3DMark TimeSpy test generated a score of 361, and it shows that at 1440p you get around 30 frames per second with games such as Apex Legends, and at 1080p you can get as high as 140 frames per second with games such as Grand Theft Auto 5. And for benchmarks that determine rank chart position, the AnTuTu benchmark generated a score of 349,338. And in PCMark 10 it got 2,727. Here is its video editing score and its web browsing score, both of which will be added to the chart. So the scores are in, and the Mini S12 at the time of making this video is at position 11 based on its PCMark 10 benchmark score. However, there are other benchmarks and features in this list to take into consideration depending on your needs, so to view this chart, see the link in the description below. So to confirm that the benchmarks are accurate, here I'm running Destiny 2 on the Steam platform, and it's having quite the difficulty in rendering smooth graphics, with an average of 11 frames per second at 1080p on low graphics. For retro gaming, once you have your library of ROMs, you can install the Retroarch platform and play Nintendo 64 and PlayStation with ease. So to conclude, I always attempt to install two of my favorite alternative operating systems that run on Windows hardware. First, I attempted to install Android x86, and in spite of using the latest BlissBass version, it failed to install due to not having the right kernel for Intel 12th generation chipsets, so it never gets past this installation screen. My next favorite alternative operating system used to be FydeOS. But in spite of updating to the latest ChromeOS version, their Android subsystem remains at Android 9. So I stopped using FydeOS, and I'm now using the ChromeOS server build via the Brunch framework. And with this new ChromeOS method, I have full access to the Google Play Store and Play services via its Android 11 64-bit subsystem. I can play Netflix, Prime Video, and other movie streaming services in HD 1080p quality via the Chrome browser without the need for DRM permissions because it's already built into the OS.
Unchecked, the caterpillars would strip them bare.
You can watch YouTube videos in 4K 2160p resolution with HDR, however, it does not trigger the HDR feature on my TV. For those who were looking for a way to root FydeOS version 12 and later and had no success, using the ChromeOS server build you can get root access for any app via a custom root system using a new kernel SU application. This app does not work on FydeOS and it requires some configuring on the Brunch framework before you can use it. Once installed, you can apply root permissions to any app that needs it without rooting the entire Android subsystem, allowing you to enjoy the best of both worlds without compromising your security. You get high performance Android gaming, and it has the high benchmarks to back it up. You can sideload any APK via external storage, via USB, via download, or via your favorite APK app store such as Aptoid or APK Pure. The only downside to this operating system is that you don't get HDR display, Dolby Vision, or any Dolby and DTS audio formats. Please note, installing alternative operating system is purely experimental, and it's something you do at your own risk, and it's not part of the PC's core function of Windows 11. This demonstration is just to show that the PC can facilitate alternative operating systems. In summary, Beelink is one of the best manufacturers of mini PCs, and there are many things you can do with this S12 Pro model. I would classify it as a high-performance budget model, as you can get one for just around $179 with a $10 coupon down from $189, and it's just in time for you to take advantage for the Black Friday sales event, so see the link in the description below this video if you would like to purchase. Thanks for watching. Give this video the thumbs up to support the reviews that I do on this channel. As usual, I know these videos raises a lot of questions about my methods and procedures, so you can post your questions in the comments section below. If you are just landing on one of my videos for the first time, then I appreciate your support, and I only ask that you subscribe to my channel by clicking the subscribe button and ringing the notifications bell to receive notifications each time I release a new video, as I would love to have you again in my next release. I appreciate your time taken to watch this video. Stay tuned and see you in the next one.